بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. My dear students, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. This is the fifth vice lecture. It is one of the very, very, very important topics regarding international accounting. We are dealing with two main topics: multinational consolidations and foreign currency translation. It's so important.
Consolidated financial statements combine the separate financial statements of two or more companies to yield a single set of financial statements as if the individual companies were really one. So suppose that we have a mother company in England, and I have a subsidiary in Egypt. I have the financial statements of the subsidiary as well as the financial statements of the mother company. How to combine these statements together? The income statement of the mother company and the income statement of the subsidiary in Egypt. The financial position statement of the mother company and the financial statement of the subsidiary in Egypt. The cash flow statement in England and the cash flow statement in the subsidiary in Egypt. How to consolidate, how to amalgamate these statements. So consolidated financial statements combine the separate financial statements of two or more companies to yield a single set of financial statements as if they are one from the first beginning, as if the individual companies were really one. What is the logic for preparing consolidated financial statements? Often, a business finds it better to organize itself as a set of separate legal corporate entities rather than as one large corporate entity. For example, tax savings sometimes occur because of the way corporate income tax rates are structured or organized. Or it might find this is better to limit the legal liabilities. Or it may help the company in competition, because it will not one company, it will be five companies, five branches of the same company. So suppose that there are four companies in the market, and our company, so the total is five. So the competition between five companies, if my company, the fifth one, is divided into five branches and the main company itself, so the companies in the market will be 10. So the competition will be less regarding the fifth main company, the fifth mother company, because there are five other branches working under the umbrella of the fifth company, and so on. From an economic point of view, the activities of these various legal entities or branches are centrally administered from the corporate headquarters or from the mother company. Thus, the intent of consolidated financial statements is to provide financial accounting information about the group of companies from an overall perspective or view from the users of these financial statements point of view. Transactions among the members of the corporate family are not included on consolidated financial statements, but only assets, liabilities, revenues and expenses with external third parties are shown, and this is something logic. Suppose that I lended my wife $100. So I will ask her to give me the $100. She will give me this $100 if she is preparing her own statements and I am preparing my own statements. Suppose that we amalgamated in one company, the debt of my wife will offset my rights of the $100. So the accounts receivable of Adel Taha
and the notes, the accounts payable of Adat Taha's wife will be offsetted just when amalgamating the two companies together in one company. I hope that this example is clarifying the matter for you. Taking a simple example, assume the following selected items from the individual financial statements of the parent and one of its subsidiaries. We have some elements, some items, some accounts, cash account, receivables, payables, revenues, and expenses. So we have two items of assets, cash and receivables. We have one item, liability, payables. Then I have revenues and expenses. For the parent, the values are in the second column, for subsidiary in the third column. The question now, subsidiary owes parent $50. The subsidiary owes parent $50. Subsidiary rented some machinery from parent for 400 baht. Okay. Regarding the rent, have the subsidiary rented some machinery, so there is an expense for the subsidiary equal 400. Included in the expenses of the subsidiary, that is 1,900 in the third column. At the same time, this rent as an expense for the subsidiary represents a revenue for the parent, so the revenues of 2,000 in the parent column, that is column number 2, includes 400 rent receivable from subsidiary. Logically, the 400 in the 2,000 revenues and the 400 as expenses in the 1,900 expenses of the subsidiary should be omitted, should be cancelled, should be offsetted, as the two are preparing now consolidated statements, so the 2,000 will be 1,600 only. The 1,900 expenses will be 1,500 only when amalgamating. Add the subsidiary owes parent $50, so the parent wants $50 from the subsidiary. So there is receivables for the parent, that's a 360, includes $50, will be taken, will be collected, will be received from subsidiary. And there is payable of 50 in the 100 payable of subsidiary will be paid to the parent. When consolidating, the 100 payable of the subsidiary will be decreased by the 50. And the 360 receivable of parent will be decreased by the same 50, here as receivables and here as payables. So, the explanation now explains that the $50 receivable that parent includes on its financial statements and the 50 payable included on subsidiaries' statements represent an intercompany item. Similarly, what relates to the rent, 400 as an expense and as a revenue. Since the purpose of consolidated financial statements is to treat the separate entities as if they were one, it would be incorrect to include these items on the consolidated financial statements. After all, the company cannot owe sense. Look now, accountants handle these kinds of matters by preparing a consolidation worksheet as illustrated below. I have a details column, that is the first one, including cash, receivables, payable, revenues and expenses. I have the parent column as it was in the example itself. I have the subsidiary column, the same. Then I have elimination two columns, debit and credit, as well as a consolidated column at the last column. If you look now, we will debit parent by 50. Why? Because the payable will be lessened by 50. So the 90
the 100 Babel of the subsidiary will be decreased because the subsidiary Babel is credit. When I make it debit, so I will decrease it by 50. So it will be 50 only. 50 plus 90 gives 140. Now the receivable of the parent, it is 360. Receivable is an asset, so it is a debit item. When I credit it by 50, so it will be 310 plus 280, it gives 590. Again, to explain it well, account for revenues and expenses. We said that the subsidiary rented a machine from the parent, so there is expenses of 400. Expenses 1,900 of the subsidiary includes 400 to be omitted. So the 1,900 as expense debit, I will credit it by 400. So it will be 1,500 plus 1,600 gives 3,100. Again, revenues of the parent 2,000. Including 400 will not be collected after amalgamation. So the 2,000 as revenue, it is a credit item, revenue. I will make it debit to cancel the 400. It will be 1,600 plus 2,300. It gives 3,900. That's why total of parent and total of subsidiary, if we will add them together, there is 450 will be deducted as debited and 450 as credited. So 900 will be decreased. So the amount will be 7,905. Thus, on a consolidated basis, receivables are 590, payables are 140, revenues are 3,900, and expenses total 3,100. Again, the purpose of consolidated financial statements is to present information from an overall or comprehensive perspective about a group of companies under common control and operating as just one economic unit. Bisco Master Company is an example with its three companies or three branches, ICA, Arabesco, and Bisco Master. Foreign currency translation and concentrate deeply, please. The foreign subsidiaries of multinational corporations, MNCs, normally keep their accounting records and prepare their financial statements in a currency of the country in which they are located. So I have a main company in US. Its financial statements are prepared using dollars. US dollars. This company has a subsidiary in US, United Kingdom. So the financial statements of the subsidiary in the United Kingdom will be in sterling bound. There is a subsidiary in Saudi Arabia. So the financial statements will be with the Saudi Arabia currency, I mean the Saudi riyal. There is a fourth subsidiary or a third subsidiary in Egypt. So the financial statements are prepared using the Egyptian pound as a currency in Egypt. So as a result, the individual financial statements of a multinational's foreign subsidiaries are expressed in many different currencies. For example, a US multinational corporation may have a separate foreign subsidiary financial statements expressed in Egyptian pound, Saudi riyals, sterling pound, Japanese yen, etc. Yet, for worldwide consolidated financial statements to be prepared, the subsidiaries' financial statements must all be expressed in a single currency, that is, the US dollar for the US multinationals. It is not possible, for example, to add up the value of assets items if they are expressed in different currencies. Can I add 500,000 Egyptian pound for land, plus $200,000 for building, for 100,000 furniture in Saudi Arabia riyal? I think it is not logical. Therefore, whenever multinational corporations prepare their consolidated financial statements, the financial statements of individual foreign subsidiaries must be translated from their currencies into the currency of the country where the multinational is headquartered, I mean the mother company, using the suitable exchange rates. What about the exchange rates? An exchange rate is the price of one currency relative to another. That's how much of one currency it takes to buy so much of another currency. Those who have traveled outside Egypt probably exchanged their Egyptian pounds travelers' checks for some foreign currency. You may recall seeing quoted exchange rates in bank windows or stores. Exchange rates are not stable over time. They fluctuate just like the price of nearly everything else does. Exchange rates are not stable over time. They fluctuate just like the price of nearly everything else does. Exchange rates changes for the many reasons such as trade balance of payments, surplus or deficit affects the exchange rates. Relative rates of inflation and interests. So the rates of interest regarding loans, the rates of inflation affects the exchange rates of currency. Political factors and government intervention, as in Egypt or as any country, political factors affect and government interventions either to stabilize the rate or to fluctuate the rate, to leave it for supply and demand, or to put a fixed rate. And the financial statements, foreign currency translation. There are four kinds of currency to deal with. Functional or home currency, reporting currency, foreign currency, local currency. The functional or home currency in the country where the company operates. So in Egypt, it is Egyptian pound. In Saudi Arabia, it is Saudi riyal, and so on. Reporting currency where the parent company prepares its statements. So preparing the statements with a currency, normally the mother company currency, or it may be another currency. We call it reporting currency because the reports are using or are dealing or are presented using this currency. So reporting currency. Foreign currency, any other currency rather than the functional one. So the home currency is known. Any other currency is called foreign currency. Local currency, a currency of a particular company being referred to, so it may be called functional. Also, note that the functional currency could be either reporting or foreign currency. Now, translation methodologies. There are four methods. We will use two only in our course. We have current non-current method we will not use, but you have to know. We have monetary and non-monetary currency method we will not use. Then we have current rate method and temporal method. They are the main two methods we are using in this course, and we will use in our examples 1, 2, and 3 just in this lecture. Current rate, all items are to be translated according to the current rate, except, I will tell you except what? Except revenues and the expenses will be on what is called average rate. And except dividends, it has a certain rate. Is an under the current method, all the items will be translated using what is called the current rate. Except dividends has a special rate. Revenues and expenses, we are using what is called average rate. But any other items will be according to the current rate. Okay, there is what is called temporal method. Cash, receivable, payables, either current or non-current, long-term, short-term, are to be translated at the current rate. Other assets, that is fixed assets, and liabilities are to be translated at current or historical as the case. And I will give you a table considering this, depending on their characteristics or nature, except dividends has a certain rate. Beginning and ending inventory has other two rates, as well as inventory expenses and revenues at average rate, except COGS has to be calculated according to what I will tell you in our examples. We will concentrate on current and temporal methods, as I told you. Please concentrate well in these examples because they are so important, and maybe the two methods consume 10 questions or more in your exam. Now, the current method, better to begin with the income statement. We will translate the income statement and the financial position statement. But better to translate first the income statement. And the resulted gains and losses will appear in the second statement, that's financial position. Under the temporal method, better to begin with the financial position statement. Why? Because the resulted gains and losses of translation appears in the income statement. Again, the current method, better to begin by the income statement. Try to discover why, you will get it while we are solving. Current rate for all assets and liabilities. Historical rate for capital stock only. Average rate for all revenues and expenses. A certain rate for dividends. Okay? Note that translation gains or losses affect the stockholders' equity through the accumulated adjustment account in the financial position statement. The temporal method, better to begin with the financial position statement. Try to get the reason. You will know it while solving. Current rate for cash, receivables, and liabilities. Liabilities either long-term or short-term. Historical rate for depreciation, fixed assets, capital stock. Average rate for revenues and expense rather than COGS. And depreciation will be historical. For inventories at their acquiring and ending dates, there is a certain rate for beginning and ending inventory. A certain rate for dividends. A certain rate for dividends. Note that translation gains and losses appear through the income statement by its now name. Example. The Grover Company is a British subsidiary of a U.S. firm. So I have a U.S. firm, the mother company. Its subsidiary is Grover Company in British. The following statements are available. Values are in thousand. Income statement for the year ended December 31st, 2015. I have sales. Then I have COGS, depreciation, other expenses, and their total. The difference operating income. Minus income tax gives net income. Plus returned earning at beginning gives a total, minus dividends distributions gives retained earning at end. Okay. Financial position statement. As at December 31st, current assets in 2014-2015. Cash and receivable, inventory, and their total. Fixed assets, lands, buildings, equipments, and their total. Then total of current assets and total of current fixed assets gives total assets. Thank you. Current liabilities, long-term liabilities, not payable, deferred income tax and their total. Stockholders' equity, capital stock, returned earning, the total. Now, current assets, current liabilities plus long-term liabilities plus stockholders' equity gives the total of the liability and equity side, which equal the asset side or the part of the assets upstairs, upwards in the financial position statement, because it is not a balance sheet, it is a financial position statement, and down you found the total of the other site if we are preparing a balance sheet. Noted that at December 31st, 2014, returned earnings amount 11,560 according to the current method, while it equals $12,360 according to the temporal method. Why he gave me this item? The retained earnings under the temporal and under the current, because these two figures we got when translating last year, you haven't last year, and the translation last year, you will deal with 2015, the existed year. So you will be in need of these two items in dollars, because the items you have in the subsidiary is relating to England. So it is in sterling bound. So you want to translate it to dollars. But these two items you will not have, so the values are given as you see. And you are required to use the following rates to translate the available two statements, the income statement and the financial position statement, using the two well-known methods, current and temporal method. Taking into consideration that exchange rates from British sterling bound, because all the items of the income statement and the financial position statement we saw in the previous two slides were in sterling bound. For the subsidiary you have in England, the sterling bound to American dollar, sterling to US dollar, are as follows. Historical rate 1.85, current rate 1.56, average rate 1.53. Dividend rate 1.55. Rate at December 31st, 2014 for inventory 1.50. Rate of December 31st, 2015 for inventory 1.45. Take care. The sterling bound equal $1.85, equal $1.56, $1.53. $1.55, $1.50, $1.45, according to the kind of the rate. The historical rate will not be used under the current method except for, right, capital stock. Only. Current rate will be used for all items of the financial position statement except capital, as I told you. Average rate will be used for all the items in the income statement. Dividend rate will be used for dividend. Rate of December 31st and December 14 and December 31st 15 will not be used under the current method, but will be used when calculating COGS under temporal method. Okay? Again, 1.85 as historical rate will be used under current method for capital stock only. The current rate will be used for all assets and liabilities in the financial position statement under the current method. Average rate will be used for all the items of income statement under current method. Dividend rate will be used for the dividends. Right? What about the temporal? Historical rate will be used for capital stock, for fixed assets, and for depreciation. The current rate will be used for other assets and other liabilities. Average rate will be used for revenues and expenses except COGS. Dividend rate for the dividends. The inventory at beginning and at end under temporal also has their have their own rates, will not be translated using current or historical rate. Now we want to solve. Solution. Firstly, using current method. Translated income statement using the current method for the year ended December 31st, 2015. Sales minus expenses, COGS, depreciation, other expenses, Total expenses if deducted operating income minus income tax give net income. Returned earning at beginning to be added give me total minus dividends give me returned earning at end. Note that the first column is sterling bound as in the example itself. The same column. Then I have the rate that to be used and the value in dollars in the last column. What is the rate to be used? As I told you, all the items of expenses and revenues as I am in current method will be the average. Average rate is 1.53. As you see, all the rates in the third column is 1.53 except dividends had its own rate. What about the red written word given, the returned earning at beginning, 5,000, what it equals in dollars, he gave it to me in the example. And he gave it regarding temporal method also. Okay? So I will multiply by 1.53 all the items. And the 5,000, I will write its value as it is given in the example. Only dividends will be multiplied by 1.55 to get the result. Is there any problem? Nothing. We are translating from sterling bound to dollars. And the ending or returned earnings at end, 13,845 dollars. That will appear in the financial position statement. So it will be taken from here to be mentioned in the financial position statement while we are translating as follows. Where is ending returned earning at end? 13,845. From where? From income statement. From income statement. What about these figures? These are the sterling bound that given in the example in the financial position statement. What is the rate that will be used? All items will be multiplied by current rate except capital stock, historical. By this way, I can multiply to get the values in dollars. Concentrate well, please. Now, I have the current assets and their total. I have the fixed assets and their total, and I have the total assets after translation. Please take the $35,100 and put it as total of liabilities and equity. Okay? Right. Because assets equal liabilities and equity. Right. I have current liabilities after translation. Okay, I multiply this by that. I have long-term liabilities and their total. Yes. I have the capital stock after multiplied by 1.85. Yes. I have the returned earning at end from the income statement. Right. So this is the total equity. Total equity plus total long-term liabilities plus current liabilities. It should equal 35,100. Unless there is loss or gains as a result of translation. So the 35,100 as total assets, I took it and write it as total of liabilities and equity. As the total equity and long-term and short-term liabilities are not equal to this, the difference appear either negative or positive as losses or gains after translation, or as a result of translation. Okay? We want to repeat, but using secondly, using temporal method. I will begin financial position statement. Preferable to begin by it. Okay. These are the sterling bound of the financial positions items. What are the rates that will be used? I will tell you again, under temporal method. I have a separate rate for beginning and ending inventory. I will use historical rate for capital and fixed assets. I have a separate rate for dividends. So other items will be using current. So cash and receivable, current rate. Inventory has its own rate. This is inventory at end, as you see. Fixed assets will be, will use historical rate. Current liabilities, long-term liabilities, current rate. As the current assets. What about the capital? Historical as fixed assets. What about nothing else? If you will add the fixed assets and take this total to put it for liabilities and equity, then you have current liability, you have a total long-term liabilities. Then if you add current liabilities after translation, long-term liabilities after translation, and deducted from the total assets, that is the total liabilities and equity, gives you total liabilities, gives you total equity. Total equity means capital stock plus returned earnings. So you deducted, you get stentiqued the returned earnings, 12,255, to be taken to the income statement. As we will see now. This is the income statement. And this is the 12,255 that we got from financial position statement. How to translate? He told me that all the items will be translated using current method, except depreciation, historical rate. So the current rate will be used for, excuse me, this is income statement. The average rate will be used for all items except COGS. I will calculate it in a certain table now to get its value. Depreciation will be at historical rate. Dividends has its own rate. So 153 regarding sales, this is average. Other expenses, this is average. Income tax, this is average. Dividends has its own rate. Depreciation should be at historical rate. The COGS, I will calculate its value and put it here. Okay? Don't forget that the financial position statement, I got the ending returned earnings after translation and put it at the end of the income statement here. Now, I will tell you how we got the 14,040 now. Sales, if I will deduct out of it COGS, it gives me operating income. But I will not use this method now. I will take it from down to up. How? I have the retained earning at end from the financial position. Dividends, when calculating it, translating it, if I will deduct it from 13,030, I will get the 12,255. But I haven't the 13,030. But I have the 12,255. So add the 775 to 12,255 to get 13,030. I got 13,030. Okay? And I have the returned earning given in the example. How much I will add 12,360 to get 13,030? So the difference between 12,360 and 13,030 gives 670. I got it. 670 means operating income that I don't know minus taxes. But taxes after translation, I know it. So how much I should deduct 2,907 from to give 670? So I will add 2,907 plus 670 to get 3,577. That is operating income. Now, operating income to get it, you have to deduct sales minus all expenses. But if you deduct sales minus all expenses and will not get the operating income, so there is a mistake. No, it is not a mistake. It is the result of translation. This means that this item minus 27,540 gives 14,040, 5,550, 2,3,213, and 1,160 that it deducted as a translated loss. How I calculated the 14,040 is cost of goods sold, beginning inventory. I have these items from the balance sheet, the inventory from the balance sheet, purchases not found, but I have COGS in the income statement. I have ending inventory also from the financial position statement. So to get this, I have COGS 9,000. If I will add 4,500, that's ending inventory, it gives me the available. The available, if I will deduct the 3,000 at beginning inventory, gives the purchases. These items to be translated using average for purchases. Beginning inventory has its own rate. Ending inventory has its own rate to get COGS, that is 9,000, after translation 14,040. Now we are in need of a second example to be sure that we understood well. Example two. You are asked to translate the following statements using the current method, if you know that. Dividend rate, average rate, historical rate, current rate, and I have ending inventory rate and beginning inventory rate. I think I did. I will not use both rates because I am not in the temporal method. And he told me that returned earning at beginning of the year equal 9,200. I need this 9,200. Yes. I need all these rates except beginning inventory and ending inventory. I don't need because we need these two rates in case of using temporal method. Okay. Income statement. What are the rates to be used in solving this example? All the items will be average rate except dividends, right? Okay. What about the financial position statement? All the items will be at the current rate except equity, capital, that will be translated using historical rate. Now, this is the income statement. These are the items in the sterling pound to translate, or in the dollar to translate it to Egyptian pound. So I will multiply by 5.6, 5.6, 5.6, 5. This is average rate. What about 5.4? This is for dividend given. What about the returned earning at beginning? He gave me that it equals 9,200 Egyptian pound, right? Okay. Okay. Financial position statement. All the items in the dollar. And they will multiply by the rate between dollar and the Egyptian pound, as he gave me. All will be according to current rate, except, yes, capital. I will use historical rate. The yes, capital here. Capital account, equity, capital. This is the historical rate. But all these are current rates. All these are current rates, okay? After adding the assets, this figure will be downwards for the equity and liabilities. As I have the capital and the returned earning from the income statement, then I have translated the liabilities, either long-term or short-term, and I have their total. So total capital plus returned earning at end plus liabilities, it should give 206,500. But there is a difference of 3,550 that is deducted tam istintago as accumulated translation adjustment as a loss or profit
In first example, it was a negative, and here it is in positive. So here it is gains, and there it was loss. But regards example three, using the data given in previous example, you are asked to translate each of the income statement and the financial position statement through the temporal method. Do you know why, or did you understand now why I gave you inventory at beginning and the inventory at end rates in the previous example? Because you will use it here. And I told you that retained earning at January 1st, that was 9,000 and I don't remember, in the current 7,970 Egyptian pound. Beginning inventory amounted for 200. For 200. Where is ending inventory? What is appear in the financial position statement is the ending inventory. Now, I begin by financial position statement. What are the rates that we will use? All the items are current except capital. We will use historical. Fixed cost, we'll use historical cost. What else? Only nothing else. Inventory. Inventory has its special rate, ending inventory. So current rate for historical rate for land and building, for tools and machinery, for capital, and I have current rate for cash and receivable, but a certain rate for inventory at end, and I have a rate for inventory at beginning will appear in COGS calculation. Okay, after translating these items, I will add all the assets. The total 199,025. Take this total to write it regarding equity and current and the liabilities. Then the liabilities, I have them and their total. If deducted from the grand total, it gives 110,525. It means equity. Equity is represented in capital and retained earning. This retained earning is deducted, تم استنتاجه, and we will use at the end of the income statement, 37,075. 37,075, right? What about the items here? Sales according to average. COGS will be calculated. Depreciation according to historical. Dividends has its own rate. Yes, its own rate. That is it. 5.4. Retained earning at beginning. Its value in dollars is given in example 3 as he gave it to me. What about depreciation? Historical. What about sales revenue? Average. What about COGS? I have to calculate. How? Beginning inventory, I have it. He gave it to me. Ending inventory, I have it in the financial position statement. Purchases, I don't have. Yes, but I have COGS from the income statement. COGS, if I will add the ending inventory, I will get the available. If I will deduct from it the beginning inventory, that is for 200, I get purchases. Purchases will be multiplied by average rate. Beginning inventory has its own rate. Ending has its own rate. After translation, I will get COGS 123,795 that is used in the income statement, 123,796. Now, please concentrate with me. This figure as ending retained earning, I got it from financial position statement. And I have dividends after translation. Can I get 64,075? Yes, I can. I have this figure regarding retained earning at beginning. So using this figure and this one, the difference gives me the net income. The net income, okay, if I will deduct sales, deduct from sales, give me the remaining these items. I have COGS calculated. I have depreciation. If deducted, I will give you the translation loss. I hope that you understood.
I hope that if there is any question, you can ask me through the email you have and through the accountingaspect.blogspot.com, and see you after ما ربنا يزيح الغمة اللي احنا فيها ان شاء الله. And there is another lecture. The last lecture will be after this lecture ان شاء الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.